This is the show all about the South. Welcome back to the Y'all Show. And is your tummy making sounds? Are you getting a little hungry? Are you ready for some good food talk and barbecue barrister talk? Yes, you are. And we're not going to hold our barbecue barrister in the shadows anymore. It's time right here on the show that's all about the South to let Mr. Matt Heermans come back on the show. And I've got some surprises, as I often do here with him, and a whole lot of fun. Everybody, hold your applause. Okay, now let's hear it for our barbecue barrister, Matt Heermans. Hello, sir.
Hello, hello. I'm ready for these surprises. I'm on the edge of my seat, literally.
Yes, you are. And we do have surprises. As I said, lots of really fun, great surprises, Matt Heermans. Okay, so we've talked a lot about some sides that go along with barbecue. We've talked a lot about barbecue with you, but we really haven't spoken about two of these items that I'm going to bring up. And then, as a fun escape from the coronavirus, you and I are going to go, in our minds at least, to a place that is near and dear to me that I haven't been to in quite some time. And it's a place maybe not quite so near and dear to you, but you've actually just come from there before the shutdown. So, yeah, we're going to go to Charleston and get some of Matt Heermans' great cuisine, maybe what he was able to do right before everything got shut down. So that's coming up in the next segment. But let's first, if you don't mind, let's kind of bring two things together that sometimes are brought together, and that's potato salad and seasoning, specifically the maybe not Cajun seasoning, but the Creole seasoning that you'll sometimes find in the grocery store, the Tony Sacheries of the world. And I want to get your thoughts on potato salad and also how you can mix in some seasoning and more than just seasoning as well. Is that too much of an ask of you here today?
Not at all. Not at all.
All right. Well, we'll start out with potato salad, if you don't mind. So, Matt Heermans, you have, like me, a little bit of an European heritage. Yours is more of a Denmark, or is it more? No, yours is more Netherlands and Dutch. Mine's more of the southern Germany portion, the Baden-Württemberg is where my folks come from. So potato salad is kind of a big deal in that part of the world, and it's kind of a big deal here in this part of the world. So just immediately when I say potato salad, Matt Heermans, what say you?
Immediately I think of, you know, the great divide, the Grand Canyon of division. You got the regular creamy potato salad and the mustard potato salad, right?
Yes.
And that's kind of the divide. I happen to be a mustard guy myself. I like all potato salad. And I think if we talk about seasoning and maybe putting a little spice to it, we'll probably go that route. But I guess I would fall on the yellow, on the mustard side of the potato salad. How about you?
I like mustard, no doubt about it. I do. It looks really pretty, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it is a nice color, but I think it adds a little bit of tang. That's kind of what I grew up eating, is the mustard salad. Again, I'm not going to force the regular mayo salad off my plate, but the mustard is I'm going to go with mustard. Team mustard. Team yellow.
Yes, let's go up against all those other faux potato salads. So I know I'm kind of not coming here with a lot of advice and how to pull this segment off. So if you can, I know you've got a very large brain inside there and below that hat you're wearing. Can you kind of recite as best you can any kind of ingredients and how to whip up said potato salad that is of a mustard variety?
Absolutely. So we'll start, start with the basics, and they all start the same, right? So you're going to have mayo, you're going to have potatoes, usually cooked. First of all, not usually cooked, must be cooked. What I should have said is usually we have the red potatoes, the little red German potatoes. So you're not going to have a big, Idaho russet, Yukon gold or whatever, these, baked potato, right? The big brown one. You're not going to use those for potato salad necessarily. You're going to use little red German potatoes, and you're going to boil them until they're soft, because a potato that isn't boiled or cooked properly, it's like an apple, except not delicious at all. So I'm going to start with cooked potatoes either way. Most people cube them. Whatever size you like is good. Some people like skin on the potato salad. Some people like skin off the potato salad.
And you're a skin on or skin off kind of guy?
You know what? I'm extremely divisive on the mustard question, Ooh. But I'm extremely inclusive on the skin question.
You liberal, you.
Yeah, I can be extremely divisive, and then it's very inclusive and tolerant at the same time. So, I like either way, but it starts with mayo. You're going to have chives. You're going to have diced onions. Some people put, after that, you got a little bit of seasoning, salt and pepper. Some people like a little bit of sugar in there. Then, of course, if you go the mustard route, you take that recipe there and you just add mustard to it. So just because it's mustard potato salad, it still starts with mayo. You can't put pure mustard in there and mix it in. It's going to be a mustard bomb from you know where. So those are the basics. Cooked potatoes, red potatoes, diced, skin on or skin off is okay. Now, we talked a little bit at the beginning about seasoning, and you mentioned Tony Sacheray's Creole Cajun seasoning, very similar.
Is there a difference between Creole and Cajun seasoning?
Well, the seasoning itself, I think it's pretty similar. You're going to have onion powder, you're going to have green pepper powder, you're going to have some heat from cayenne. As far as the Cajun people and Creole people, that's a whole different show, John. But I think the seasonings are similar. You're talking about essentially a spicy kind of a dehydrated trinity with some cayenne. So got to be careful with it. They're real salty. If anybody's ever tried Tony Sacheray, Slap Your Mama, there's all kinds of different brands out there. You know that with the heat comes a lot of salt. So very tasty. I'm a big fan of those seasonings myself, especially if I'm going to cook a Cajun dish, but you got to go easy on it. So spicy potato salad, definitely a thing. Little bit of Tony Sacheray's goes a long way. There's some regional hot sauce brands that are really good if you're going to start with mayo potato salad and make it spicy. So Crystal happens to be my favorite. You've got Louisiana, which has the red dot on it. There is Texas Pete, I think, out of North Carolina. I don't know where Frank's Red Hot's from. I prefer Crystal or Louisiana myself, but everybody's got their favorite hot sauce, I think, that you're kind of loyal to. I buy huge bottles of Crystal and go through it. But that's real easy. You make a potato salad, you start with the mayo base, add a little bit of hot sauce, maybe a dash of the Tony's, and then all of a sudden you've got Cajun or you've got blackened potato salad. So really good stuff. Really a lot of options out there.
You never disappoint, Matt Heermans, our barbecue barrister.
Tell my wife that. Yeah.
Wife, Matt, our barbecue barrister, he never disappoints.
All right. I like it.
And that's no April Fool's joke here. We're talking to Matt Heermans, our barbecue barrister. This is the Y'all Show. We're having fun. Little potato salad talk. And we've got Charleston talk coming up as well. So I know you don't want to necessarily endorse anybody, but are you okay with Tony Sacheray's? Because to me, that seems like the Cadillac, the McDonald's of all those Creole seasonings. Are you okay with that product?
The Cadillac and the McDonald's?
Yeah.
That seems like opposite ends of the spectrum.
But let me clarify for our Louisiana fans. This is kind of like the Popeyes of Creole seasoning.
I see what you mean. It's the, Kleenex is nasal tissue, right? It's that. Yeah, I know what you mean. I think it's great. I think there are other brands that are great out there, too. You know, there's Zatarain's, there's Slap Your Mama. I like Tony's.
Do you?
I mean, okay. I always have. And I just call it Tony's. I think a lot of people do. But I like it a lot. It's good.
If you've ever been around Louisiana, and I know you have, and many of our listeners and viewers here on the Y'all Show, if you ever get within, let's say, 500 miles of Louisiana, you're going to start seeing all these different types of hot sauces that you've never heard of. Because I think, honestly, every other person in Louisiana has their own hot sauce. So the question to you, Matt Heermans, are the seasonings from Louisiana as numerous as the hot sauce varieties?
I would say more.
Really?
There are so many seasonings. The one I didn't even mention is the most obvious is Tabasco. Big Tabasco fan.
Well, I know they've got hot sauce. Do they have seasoning?
Oh, right. I was kind of backtracking a little bit. But, there's all kinds of every gas station, particularly South Louisiana, at the Acadiana, that's kind of what we're talking about. there's so many seasonings. There's five different varieties of Tony's, but there's five different varieties of Slap Your Mama. There's Zatarain's. I mean, we've talked about it before. I think one of our listeners wrote in that white pepper makes everything better. Well, I like white pepper a lot, and this makes me think of a brand out of, I want to say Opelousas, but I could be wrong. I've mentioned it before, Slap Your Mama. That's another kind of seasoning. They have a white pepper-based Cajun seasoning, which is unique. If you like white pepper, you should look into that. Go to the website. I guess they have one. But, oh, yeah, there's seasonings galore. You could go to any little shop around, and there's more seasonings than there's more seasonings in Louisiana than there are barbecue seasonings in Memphis, and that's saying a heck of a lot. Because I know you've been and you've seen how many seasonings there are there, but there's tons. Everybody's got their seasoning in Louisiana.
If I can confess, Matt Heermans, our barbecue barrister and just an all-around barbecue snob, I'll go ahead and say that. I've spent time in Memphis. You've spent time in Memphis. But, son, I'm no guy that's going to go around all over Memphis researching barbecue sauces and other products. So I'll just have to take your word. I'm a rendezvous kind of guy. And a couple of other ones, and I'm okay with that.
Okay. All right. Yeah, well, long story short, there's a heck of a lot of seasonings, and there's a heck of a lot of Cajun seasonings in Louisiana. I mean, dozens, right? Dozens.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you clarified. And going back to what we originally were talking about here, those seasonings from Louisiana, our great Pelican State, will be a, no matter what the brand, will be an additional wonderful addition to your potato salad. Am I deciphering that from you, sir?
Absolutely. A little sprinkle in your mayo-based potato salad, maybe more than a couple dashes of your favorite hot sauce, and you got yourself a nice Creole, nice Louisiana Gulf Coast-style potato salad.
Ooh, good stuff. Delicious stuff. Exactly the kind of thing, Matt Heermans, that I want to hear coming from you as we get ready to take a break. When we come back on the other side of this little timeout, we'll have a little potato salad and seasoning waiting for us. When we come back, we're going to go from Acadiana and the great Louisiana Pelican State to the low country of South Carolina, where Matt Heermans, just before the whole world shut down back in March, he was brave enough to go to Charleston and spend a little time, maybe had a little chance to get some food, and we're going to talk about that. We've been holding off this conversation throughout this whole coronavirus. And when we come back, we're going to learn a little bit more about his quick trip over to the Palmetto State. And we're going to actually, if you're able to watch us right now on Facebook Live or catch us on our YouTube channel, you'll be able to see some of the great scenery from Charleston. We'll mix in some audio-visual stuff for you, courtesy of our barbecue barrister, Matt Heermans. And that conversation is coming up right after this break.
Will I be able to see the...
Yeah, but it'll be delayed.
Okay.
Do you have the ability to scoot back about a half a foot? Yeah, let me see more of that pretty T-shirt. All right.
That's not that great of a...
I like it. It looks like you've been cooking. All right, here we go. Segment two, all you all. And this is the Y'all Show. We are continuing on with more of our barbecue barrister, Matt Heermans. He's got the grill in the backyard ready to go. Perhaps you have your grill ready to go. We're all cooped in, ready to do something fun and grilling. And eating great barbecue and Southern cuisine is just the right thing to get us past this. That is, until we can get our sea legs back and our ground legs back, and we can hit the roads and hit the air of the South if you're lucky enough to fly to our destinations of the South. In fact, speaking of air travel, it was just before the world came to a crashing halt a couple of weeks ago that our barbecue barrister, Matt Heermans, was able to travel to Charleston, South Carolina for a little business and perhaps a little barbecue business as well. And we haven't had a chance to talk to him about his quick trip over to the Holy City and specifically about the food that he was able to get there. Plus, he went there probably about 2 years before as well. So, barbecue barrister, please don't hold back. Tell me what cuisine from Charleston, South Carolina you were able to enjoy. And me being a little bit of a Charleston insider, I can weigh in if I agree or disagree. So, how about it?
All right. Well, I want to, say that for anybody who lives in that area, you're very lucky. I love Charleston and to the few times I've been there, I consider it to be, just very fortunate to be able to go, because it's really an incredible city. Anybody who's ever been there understands that. It's kind of a magical place.
But, it is definitely that. It's considered one of the top tourist destinations in the entire world. I think it's certainly number one in this country from Condé Nast magazine. But we can brag about all the great things in Charleston. But one of the things Charleston's known for, Matt Heermans, food.
Absolutely. Me and my lovely wife, we spent about a week there a couple of years ago, and we did get to eat some food. We ate lots of food, in fact.
Nothing wrong with that.
No, yeah. My pants a little tight on the way back on the plane, but we had, the things that you would expect that you would want to get in Charleston. That's what I firmly believe in, eating regionally and then, super regionally, I guess, wherever you go, you don't want to eat the same thing you could get in any other place. So we ate a lot of oysters, a lot of raw oysters. I was intrigued by the different areas that they had oysters from the Chesapeake Bay, from South Carolina, all the way up to New England and some of these places. All different, all great. We ate at a restaurant called Blossom on, I forget what street it's on. You probably know, but maybe
East Bay, King Street.
Yeah, East Bay. Had some really good, I think I had some blue crab stuffed raviolis, and we had some fried green tomatoes, some of the better ones I've ever had. We ate shrimp and grits.
Why were they so good? What did they do different there?
Yeah, I think with the green tomato, it's really hard to get a crispy crust. Mm-hmm. Tomatoes are wet. So obviously the reason you're frying the green tomato and not the red one is because the red one is very soft and it disintegrates. You can never fry it properly. Green tomatoes are tangy and they're unripe. So that means they're firm and you can actually fry them without them disintegrating. But it still takes a magic touch to get that perfect crispness on the outside and maintain kind of a juicy, hot tomato. It's kind of magic if you can get it right. So I have to give a shout out to the folks at Blossom there on East Bay, one of the better green tomatoes I've ever had. And it was topped with blue crab. So, I mean, pretty good way to go.
Blue crab is something Charleston's known for. And you being a guy who's an expert on all things Southern, including the Gulf cuisine, are blue crabs something you'll find in the Gulf of Mexico?
Absolutely. Blue crabs incredibly common along the Gulf up to North Carolina, about that area. So if you take, you take Texas all the way around Florida up to North Carolina, I think that's where they thrive, and they're all over the place. They are delicious. I'm partial to them, but I think anybody who's had blue crabs, if you've had a soft shell crab, you've had a blue crab.
Oh, I did not know that.
Really, really good. One of the most flavorful crabs. So we ate a lot of crab. We had a lot of seafood. We had shrimp and grits. We had.
Where'd you have shrimp and grits? Do you remember?
Oh, man. We ate so many places, John. Oh, you know what? Okay, we had a little bit of a non-traditional. We ate at a brewery called Craftsman. I'm a big, I like local beer. I like craft beer. I like being able to drink beer that's made in the place that I'm going. Mm-hmm. And they had a fried shrimp square. It was like a deep fried square of grits, pardon me. And then the shrimp was on top of it with the sauce. It was one of these like modern kind of deconstructed deal. But the fried grit cake was amazing. So not your typical shrimp and grits, but I've had a lot of shrimp and grits, and it's one of my favorite dishes. And this was really cool. It was a really good way to eat along with some local craft beer. So, again, shout out to that place, the Craftsman. Really cool spot.
I'm glad I asked the question. See, that's the kind of knowledge you would have been holding back from us. And quote your fellow Houston, Texas star, just like you're a star, a guy named Kenny Rogers, you got to know when to hold them and know when to fold them. And we wanted you to fold that. Yeah, RIP Kenny Rogers, Houston, Texas is on. But that's where shrimp and grits. I'm a little partial to the shrimp and grits of the Lowcountry, especially if you have little pieces of bacon in there and what we call the, what is that? I'm having a drawing a blank. When you make your red eye gravy. Sorry, I haven't had it in a while. Red eye gravy, which is like coffee and you put on grits and it's just delicious. Have that with some good country ham.
I have to say, I'm feeling a little bit torn here because, you know, I feel like there are two kind of famous shrimp and grits, obviously a very southern dish. You can get it from all on the Gulf Coast up to, like I say, North Carolina or so. I feel like there are two main kinds. You kind of got the Gulf Coast style that has the Cajun bent to it. A lot of times you'll have andouille sausage. You'll have some, you know, some of that Cajun Trinity there base. It'll be a darker sauce. I love that. But, and that's kind of my neck of the woods. That's what you get around where I live. And I'm a huge fan of that. I love it. But, the tomato, kind of tomato-based with crunchy bacon that I had in South Carolina, totally different, really fantastic. I actually bought a cookbook there because I liked it so much, and I've actually done a Charleston-style recipe, shrimp and grits, more times than I've done kind of my local Gulf Coast style. So I feel like a traitor a little bit, but I have to agree, really fantastic, and the style over there, really subtle. I would call it kind of a subtle, but a bacony and kind of a tomato based sauce. Really incredible. I'm a huge fan. It's my favorite.
Not sure what recipe book you got, but just
Lee Brothers.
Okay. Well, let me give you a little insider tip. In fact, as a consolation prize for you having to leave Charleston so early because of the coronavirus, we'll try to get a copy of this shipped to you at your plantation. There's a recipe book that's probably the most famous recipe book from all of South Carolina. It's called Charleston Receipts, which R-E-C-I-P-T-S. I think that's an old word for recipes or something like that. But this book was essentially written in the 19th century, and most all of the recipes are from old Charleston. And that's where I found my shrimp and grits recipe, and it's delish. That's just a little insider tip coming to you here on the Y'all Show. We're talking with our barbecue barrister, Matt Heermans. So we've talked about some of these good places that you were able to go to. I know you were on a little bit of a tightened schedule when you went there in March. Did you have any chance to go to a good restaurant? Did you have a chance to eat any barbecue while you were in the holy city in the low country of South Carolina? Or as they would say, South Carolina down in the low country.
Yeah. I'm trying to think, should I hold back? I had an interesting story about trying to eat barbecue there. I guess I'll just, you know.
Well, let's try to drag this thing out as much as possible, but give us a little taste. I mean, we don't tease us here.
No. So I've got a weird story, and then I've got a happy ending, put it that way. So I did have a few hours. So I was there over there for business. I knew I wanted to get some barbecue. I was cutting it close. There were several different options we had discussed. I thought about kind of going outside of town and doing some whole hog, kind of traditional old-fashioned style. Didn't have time to do that, so I was very close to downtown. Decided to go park down by the Battery, take a nice little walk, and hit a place called Pugin Smokehouse, which is right there in town. And I had been there before and thought it was pretty good. They've got a nice mustard-based sauce there. They had some great pork belly, ribs, pulled pork. They have a nice little thing. You can sit at the bar and have a local beer. It's a really cool place. Big fan of Pugin Smokehouse. But
on that day,
one of the strangest experiences I've ever had with a restaurant happened. So it was open. It was noon, and they opened at 11. Door open. Absolutely empty. No one in the place anywhere. Me and three other potential patrons wandered through the place, couldn't find a soul in the joint, waited around a little bit, and decided that whoever was supposed to open the place just didn't. So totally abandoned, front door wide open. I guess if they would have had barbecue laying around, I could have taken some and left the tip. But weird, very weird. However, here's the happy ending.
Yes, we need a happy ending.
Pugin's has another place. It's called the Pugin's Front Porch. It's over by the Mills House Hotel. And I ended up walking to the other Pugin's. I said, listen, this is a great franchise. I really like this place. I'm going to hit the other Pugin's. I'm going to go from Pugin's Barbecue to Pugin's Front Porch and have a little late brunch. And I did. And I sat on the front porch, and the weather was beautiful. And I had a deviled crab omelet with one of the most beautiful biscuits I've ever had in my life, served on the side with some soft butter, and it was fantastic. So I don't know what was going on with Pugin Smokehouse that day. Still a big fan. I just give a shout out to the other Pugans, the front porch, which is a real, it's like an old house. I mean, it's okay. It's awesome. So
and
anyway,
they have two Pugans within walking distance of each other.
Yeah, several blocks, but it was a beautiful day. It was about a 10-minute walk, easy. Okay.
Down the cobblestone streets of the holy city of Charleston, South Carolina. We're talking to Matt Heermans, and of course, Charleston is a beautiful place. As we said, Condé Nast has it, the number one spot in the world to travel. And Matt Heermans, of course, I'm a little skewed being from that part of the woods. There are so many people that I find who live west of Georgia that have never been to Charleston, South Carolina. They have just not had the opportunity to get in the car. I don't think they know that there's a beach in the Charleston area, and that's separate of talking about all the food, great shopping. But we have you on here today talking about all this great cuisine that you'll find in Charleston County and South Carolina, not just in the peninsula of Charleston, downtown area, but you also have great food choices across the Cooper River Bridge over there in Mount Pleasant, South Carolina. And then you've got, I was trying to steer you to the Somerville and Ladson area to go to a Bessinger's barbecue, and you didn't make it. Your time just kind of ran out. Because we still got to introduce you to South Carolina hash. Hash, not something illegal here I'm talking about. Hash is something that most South Carolinians put on rice, white rice, and they have that served up with their barbecue. You also hash and white rice with fried chicken is an incredible delicacy that Carolinians enjoy. It's usually a mustard-based bash. The hash is a mustard-based looking color, but I've seen more of a peppery hash also available in restaurants in South Carolina. And so that's something we're going to have to break that mold and get you your first dose of some good Carolina hash, Matt Heermans.
I want to try some so bad, and
I'm not going to ship that to you like I'm shipping Charleston receipts.
No. Well, I feel like it probably wouldn't be quite the same anyway. So yeah, maybe next time, if you know, Lord willing, I go back to Charleston for business or something of that nature. I'm doesn't matter how far, where I have to go, I'm going to stuff my face with some South Carolina hash for sure.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm not a nerd like you are, so I know there's meat in hash. I'm sure you've researched it. Can you tell our audience what the heck exactly, when we talk about Carolina hash, what the heck are we actually talking, as we would say in South Carolina, in the Lowcountry specifically? What exactly, Matt Heermans, are we talking about? They don't really quite say it like Canada, but go ahead.
No, it's more like a bait. I mean, it's not, dude, you sound like a Canadian, so let's not do that.
All right, sorry. Because honestly, I'm a hillbilly from about 2 hours inland of Charleston, and there's a completely different dialect. I'm envious. I wish I had that little country brogue that they got down there, but unfortunately, Lord didn't have it planned for me to live there in 843 area code. But what exactly is hash?
Yeah, so it's a lot of different ingredients, but I think the main thing that makes hash so interesting to me, and you know, for you, it's old hat, but
old hash.
Yeah, it's meat. It's usually a pork shoulder or a butt or a whole shoulder. It's cooked for so long that it almost liquefies. I mean, it sounds like it doesn't sound appetizing, but.
Is the meat, I hate to interrupt you, is this meat the same meat that goes into making barbecue, or is it a different portion of the pig?
Yeah. It can be any meat. Sometimes it's leftovers. I've done a little research, like you said, never had it.
I knew you would have, yes.
Yeah, so there's anything, you can use it for any type, any part of the pig. A lot of times if you do a whole hog, there's different parts that you maybe don't want to eat. I'm not talking about innards or organ meat. I'm talking about just pieces of the pig that may not be that tender. They get overdone when you cook a whole hog, or it can just be a shoulder, a butt. But the key is that the meat is cooked so long in a pot with other seasonings and vegetables and things like that, that the meat literally shreds apart into so fine a particles that it's like a liquid, right? So it's almost like a gravy, but it has a lot of meat in it, which is really fascinating to me, because you usually think of meat in a soup, it's a big chunk, it's like a stew, or it's, you know, we've talked about burgoo, and there's Brunswick, there's different types of stuff that has chunks of meat, but hash, very specifically, has the meat that's almost dissolved into the soup, which is pretty fascinating, and so it's unique, I would say, very unique.
It is unique and it is delicious, and I'm so sorry you missed out on the hash fun. And because your last trip there was a little bit brief, I'm sure you had a list of places you wanted to check out. Can you share with us some of the places, food-wise, that you had hoped to maybe make on this last trip, and perhaps we can kind of pencil it in for you to go back there and check these out?
Absolutely. I wanted to go to the Pugin's. We already talked about that. I had Bessinger's on the list, like you suggested to me. I was thinking about going to Melvin's. I had been to Melvin's before and was not able to make that either since I was pressed for time. There's a bar called the Blonde.
Let me stop you because it's kind of confusing. Okay. And let me tell you a little bit about South Carolina royalty. Matt, do you get along with your family?
Most of the time.
Okay. I don't always get along with my family. Sometimes we've had civil wars in my family. The Bessinger family, of which you just mentioned, is the epitome of family versus family. And that explains why, if you go to Charleston, there's Bessinger's Barbecue, there's Joe Bessinger's Barbecue, and there's even a Melvin's Barbecue. They're all the same family, but either because they didn't like each other, they disagreed about the money, maybe one might have been somebody's son. I don't know all the justification, but there's multiple Bessinger-related properties, but they're not all the same company. That explains some of the confusion when you talk about eating Bessinger barbecue. And oh, by the way, I didn't mention the biggest Civil War, and that was between Melvin and his brother, Maurice, who has a kind of a fiefdom in the Columbia, South Carolina area with a bunch of restaurants and his own sauce. And the funny thing is, the Bessingers, their ancestral home is smack dab between Columbia and Charleston in Holly Hill, South Carolina, home of Matt Singletary. And that's where they kind of started. And the two brothers went into opposite directions, and then more civil war between the family. So with all that, now that I've got that out of the way, continue on, sir. Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, so I'm just by going to Melvin's, I'm certainly not picking a side there. I would be more than happy to try every Bessinger outlet there, and I'm sure
I would too. Yes,
you know, honestly, I think probably that all these splits, I'm sure each one of them is a little bit of a different style. So I think maybe the state of South Carolina has benefited from this family rift, just barbecue wise. But
and let me go ahead and throw it out, since I mentioned that they were from Holly Hill. Do you know what's about 6 miles from Holly Hill, South Carolina? Another sort of castle of barbecue culture here in the South.
I'm drawing. No, tell me.
It would be Sweatman's.
Oh, yeah. You told me about this place too. That's Whole Hog Barbecue. Yeah.
Sweatman's is right there, just outside of Holly Hill.
That's on the list too, man. I gotta go. I gotta get back. I gotta get back soon.
In Utahville, South Carolina, spelled Utawville. A Revolutionary War battle was fought there in Utahville. And it's also, again, home of Sweatman. So I'm sorry the timing didn't work out where you could just devour all that great barbecue while you were on this last trip. But anything else before we say goodbye to you from your kind of ledger of what you're going to pull back out and go and check off the list when you get back to Charleston?
Great little bar called the Blind Tiger on Broadway. They have a fantastic pork belly and really great local beer. That was another place I was going to stop off at. But next time.
Well, I know you're a barbecue guy, but you probably know a little bit about all these micro breweries. Is Charleston known for a great beer? I don't even know the answer to that.
They are now. Yeah. Okay. Some really, really fantastic beer. I just like, I like craft beer and local beers a lot. If I called myself an expert, somebody would jump, and say, you're not, you're just a fan, which I am. So, but yeah, really great beers. There's a brewery called Westbrook. There's other great breweries too, but they have some really fantastic beers there out of Charleston.
Okay. Well, most towns now have at least one micro brewery. That's back when they were making beer. Most have converted to making hand sanitizer. we're looking forward to that switch back to making good beer pretty soon for those. And that's a whole nother conversation you and I need to have, Matt Heermans, is the right beer to mix with barbecue. Does that sound like a good combination to talk about?
Oh yeah. You can drag that out of me too. I love talking beers. I love talking beer as well. I do.
Beer, barbecue, and a whole lot more, even a little potato salad talk when we're able to get it from our big guy, Matt Heermans. Thank you for the great knowledge, and always a pleasure. We look forward to talking to you again, our barbecue barrister, Matt Heermans. Thank you, sir.
I'll see you next time.
All right. And that will wrap up our Y'all show. Thank y'all very much for being a part of the show that's all about the South. We've got another exciting episode headed your way tomorrow, so don't miss out on the fun of this, the Y'all show. And don't forget also to go to our website, y'all.com, the ultimate guide to the South. Bookmark it. Check there often. Go to our Facebook page, and that's Y'all Magazine on Facebook, y'all.com. So many ways for you to stay on top of all things Southern. Thanks for watching, and thanks for listening.